Can everybody hear me? It's time for us to get started. Can y'all hear me? Hold on, how about now? Is that good? Okay. All right, Glenn, can you hear me? Can everybody hear me? All right, good. Hello, everyone. My name's Jason Lashley, and I represent Sigma Consulting Group. I'm the project lead on this project. And before we move forward with anything else, I'd like to thank Escambia County Commissioner Burgosh, Planning, and all the residents that are here to participate in this activity. What we're here to do is hold a design charrette for the Beulah Master Plan project. The goals of this project are basically to design a community master plan to accommodate the growth for the Beulah area, but we want to establish a vision that will allow the continued growth but maintain the quality of life and sense of place enjoyed by the residents. We want to have a good balance so that everybody has a sense of ownership as we move forward. And at the end of that, we want to produce an overall master plan that we can implement and try to keep things flowing smoothly as we move forward. Key to the development of this whole process are my team members. And as I announce the team members, if they would stand up, raise your hand, nod your hand, whatever makes you the most comfortable. Our lead planner, who is very skilled, he's been doing this for a lot of years, is Javier Amana. Frank Imbruglia. Kirsten Cavender. On Sigma's team, I've got Rachel Rogers. She did an amazing job. She's in the kitchen. From Alta, I've got Eric Scott.
Good evening.
Richard Virgo.
On the front line, that's the one we're playing.
From Biome, we've got Glenn Miley. And from RMA, we've got Lynn Dellinger. But before we begin the design exercise, I would like to ask Commissioner Burgosh if he's got any items he would like to discuss before we move forward.
Thank you.
Well, good evening, everyone. Thank you very much for taking time from your busy schedules to be here. I want to thank the staff members present. My aide, Jesse Casey's here tonight. Thank you for being here. I want to thank Jamie Higdon, Tim Day, Terry Berry is here. Any other staff members that I haven't recognized, I appreciate you guys being here. But most importantly, I want to tell everyone here, I've been a long-term resident, 20 years, and this area has changed. Many of you guys have been there lived here a lot longer than me. But this is the culmination of many years' effort trying to get a plan put together to address this growth. And a lot of people, are very frustrated that we're just now doing it now. But I will tell you, it's an effort that I've been trying to do since 2017. We finally, all the stars aligned. We had a large committee of people. A lot of people gave a lot of time over nearly a two-year period before COVID. And then COVID hit. We all know what happened then. But the stars aligned, we had the money, and I want to let you all know the taxes, your taxes are not funding this. This is oil spill money from the BP oil spill. We're using that. So that was a terrible event, but at least we're going to take that money and do something good with it. And I appreciate your participation, and I just want to encourage you, participate today, participate tomorrow, and participate going forward. We all live in this community. It's a great community, and we can see kind of the benefits of a well thought out plan on OLF 8 right now with what Navy Federal Credit Union has built. If you've not had the opportunity to see that park, I would encourage you to go. It's an incredible, incredible amenity for the community. My hat's off to Navy Federal Credit Union. Check it out because it's awesome. They even have pickleball courts. Pickleball. Very cool. So without further ado, thank you to all the team members for being here tonight. Let's put the feedback in that they need. I've already drawn my circle. If you haven't drawn your circle, draw your circle, put your pin, and then go around and do all the charrettes and everything else, and appreciate y'all being here. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Commissioner Burgosh. And with that, I'd like to turn it over to Javier so he can begin the design process. Thank y'all.
Good evening. Javier Romano with CPH. Great to be back up here. We're headquartered in Central Florida, city of Orlando, and coming up here with this beautiful weather is always invigorating. Last time we were here, I believe, was in August, late August, I believe, of this year. Weather wasn't quite as attractive as it is now, but great to see the turnout. I realize at this time of year, the last thing you want to do is sit and listen to us professionals talk about potential growth. You all know, as residents, the pressures with the community itself. Transportation, too much housing, not enough housing, too much retail, not enough retail, the preservation of y'all's feeling of place, which is mostly rural in nature. And how do you balance development, people coming in and preserving the character of your study area, of your neighborhood? And that's always a challenge. And this is a challenge since the beginning of time. How do you balance those two things? And you know, you pass a lot of codes, governments can participate, but without a critical component in the design process, all these studies, all these regulations, all these codes mean absolutely nothing. And that element is citizen participation. So that's why, you know, I acknowledge the commissioner, because this is something from day one he's instilled in us. As Javier and team, you've got to listen to the community, because without that, the paper, the reports that we generate will end up at the bottom of a birdcage, so and unimplementable. So that's a critical point, and I will sound like a broken record throughout this process. And if some of y'all who are the first public workshop back in August, that's one of the things that we really instilled, is that public participation. How does that come about? We have many ways. We have workshops. This is workshop number two. I believe we have four or five scheduled throughout the process. We have a website that has been set up through the county that will contains updates and material for the process itself. I mean, this is a enormous effort. In my professional practice, this is the largest project that I've ever worked on, 30,000 acres, tremendous. Many aspects, many opinions, many metrics that we need to deal with as we move forward. So, and tonight's meeting, and this week, today and tomorrow, we have what we call a charrette. Charrette is a French word that has been customized to describe a process that's a rip, quick, rapid fire, collaborative effort to arrive at potential solutions in design. And in the Impressionist painters in France in the early 1900s would gather up their paintings and put them on a charrette. A charrette is cart, the French word for cart. So they put all their paintings in a cart, take them out to the plaza late Friday afternoon with whether a glass of vermouth or anisette or whatever, and absinthe, I think is the drink in France, and they would sell their wares. Over time, in the tradition of architecture and land planning, the Bauhaus movement, Rococo and such, that word was adopted as a means of creating community to find community-based solutions to design. It doesn't necessarily mean that it's a solution, but at least it's a step forward to create the feeling of place. And that's indeed what we're trying to do, and we will attempt to do today and tomorrow. As Jason mentioned, we have a team of professionals. We have land planners, we have landscape architects, we have transportation engineers, we have economic experts and environmental experts. We need that layer of design professionals to help us come together and put together a plan that does not concentrate on one particular aspect of a future plan for the area, because it's like the bone structure. Everything is connected. So that's what we're trying to obtain. Information not only from you all, but take that information and then analyze it based on the talent that we bring to the table, and put together a plan that makes sense, but above all has citizen participation and is implementable. In my years of practice, I've seen a lot of plans that are well-meaning, but without the impetus of and the drive of local government, those plans mean nothing. And I believe that one of the commissioner's mandates is to make it happen, to make it fundable, and to make it happen. So tonight's effort is, it's a fun effort, because in the design charrette process, day one, and that, this is a design process, kind of academic. Forgive me, I was a lecturer at the University of Florida in the design school. This is something that my professors instilled in me as to how we get to a vision plan. All parts, inventory, normative planning, which means laws, interviews, that's you all. Pardon me, y'all. Context, compatibility, connectivity. I'm from the South, but not that South. So, design options, charrette, and we come up with a vision plan. And this is a year-long project. We're in the embryonic stage. We've made a tremendous amount of progress since the last meeting that we had. We've amassed a tremendous amount of information, metrics that are will blow your mind as to what it is that we have, the natural resources here, the people. The greatest resource that this area has in the county is its people, the residents, unquestionably, because they're the ones that make it happen. We have streets. We have our friend, in quotation marks, FDOT. They're a finicky bunch. I understand that there's a plan to interchange at I-10. Great, but that has implications. How does that interchange affect traffic? How does it affect the urban design patterns? How does it affect connectivity, pedestrian connectivity? Big questions. DOT doesn't do that kind of stuff. We have to tell them, the local government, Escambia County has to deal with those things. That's why we're here, to anticipate those things and come up with regulations and designs that are implementable that will welcome that interchange in the area itself. So next slide. We've gone through these before. Can we go to the slide that has the, okay, here we go. Part one of tonight's exercise is what we call the red, green dot exercise. It's a very simple procedure and process. Basically, it's a visual survey where we have on those tables over there, layout tables, and you all can read it as well. It's a visual preference survey. So very simply, we go to one of the boards that says type of uses for housing. We have single family, we have multifamily, townhomes, we have apartments. So very simple process. You'll be handed a pack of green dots and red dots. Simply, if you like a particular image, you take that green dot, you adhere to that image. If you don't like it, you put the red one on it. A couple years ago, we did a similar exercise, a vision plan for the city of Cape Coral. And that's right, in Cape Coral. And we had a very similar exercise. The room was packed, I'd say we're about 300 people at City Hall. Unexpected turnout. And we had the boards tacked up on the walls, and we handed out the dots. And throughout the evening, we started noticing that people were actually, somebody found a stack of post-it notes. You guys were ahead of me. And all of a sudden, we see the images populated with post-it notes in addition to the dots. Unbelievable. As a designer, that to me blew my mind, because not only are we getting the visual preference with the dots, but we're getting individual comments as to why they don't like something, or we miss something, or they would like to see something. So that helped us and start defining the plan. So hopefully tonight, I know you guys aren't shy, so go ahead and take the dots themselves and help yourselves, if you wish, to a post-it note and make a comment. And if we'll have parts of the team members that will be manning some of these tables if you have any questions, don't be shy. So that would be part one of the exercise. The second part of the exercise, and I think some of you all have done this already, is start with a pin, a push pin, if you can find your location, because then you start, it gives you scale as to, you know, 30,000 acres is gargantuan. This is a massive landmass. So, but putting things in perspective, for instance, somebody wrote here, my neighborhood, all of Beulah plus Kingsfield. Fantastic comment. So you've already, from 30,000 acres, you've gone down and identified what this, and then from there, we can start looking at connectivity, water sewer services. Are there sidewalks in your neighborhood? Something that we've, in our recon of the area, I don't know how, where you all walk to, because there are no trails. There are no sidewalks. Another thing that we've noticed, and this is not a criticism, just an observation, is the subdivisions don't have any street trees.
Right.
It's that, you know, and all the, I practice all over the United States, overseas, and street trees are mandatory. It's just a given everywhere you go. Of course, with that comes maintenance, comes irrigation, which is another Pandora's box that you need to deal with. But you have to start, baby steps. So this is great. Another thing that I didn't quite expect was the markers and people actually delineating their general neighborhoods. This is fantastic. This is all great information. So this will be part two of the exercise tonight. So you all to put your push pins, and also we have some boards up there with ward association. Like, for instance, the individuals who said Kingsfield, we wanted to hear what words describe your neighborhood and what things are missing in your, not just the neighborhood, but the area itself. So what are we going to do with that information? Day two, tomorrow, starting 1:30 in this same locale, we're going to have an open design studio where all the design professionals, we're going to sit down, roll up our sleeves, and start taking, analyzing the information that we obtained tonight from the green dot exercise and the red dot exercise, plus the post-it notes. I know we're going to get a lot of post-it notes. And some of the stuff here, and we'll start classifying good, bad, indifferent, needs, wants. And we're going to take all that information and start creating designs, very loose sketches, vignettes. Like, for instance, somebody may say, we don't have enough community meetings or senior centers. We'll come up with a basic sketch of what that may look like. People may say, we have no sidewalks on our major roads. Then we come up and identify the right-of-way and then start creating some of those elements within a complete street. Who amongst you knows what a complete street is?
What?
Complete street.
It handles all modes of traffic?
No.
No?
No. A complete street is a design concept, very simple design concept, yeah, that takes the road. But a complete street is not just a road. A complete street has to take into consideration the pedestrian.
That's
transportation,
walking.
Correct. Transportation, cars, different modes of transportation, bicycles.
Right.
We have transportation experts. Where are my guys? There you go. The guys from Atlanta.
Landscape.
The Alta guys.
Landscape.
This is what they do. Landscape, signage, wayfinding. As a Central Floridian, I hadn't been up here in many, many years. I was on my way to Tuscaloosa, Alabama to see Florida beat Alabama back in the early 1990s. And it did happen. They had a running back by the name of Emmett Smith. The rest is history. And up here, when I drove up here, I had no idea where I was. No signage. Simple. Wayfinding is one of the precepts of placemaking, and we lack it. There you go. Yes. So anyway, so these elements come into what we're going to be designing tomorrow. And nothing's set in stone. We're just creating vignettes. And with all that information, we'll go back and start putting the structure of the plan itself. We have economics experts. We have Lynn sitting in the back who will help us. I start identifying potential nodes for commercial areas, given the population increases over time, which is critical. We'll be working with staff, information from staff relative to water, sewer, land use, and zoning, and start identifying nodes, mixed-use nodes, preservation nodes, areas for rehabilitation, and things of that nature. And key to design is public realm, and it goes back to transportation corridors. You guys are very wealthy in the sense that you have major transportation corridors within the 30,000 acres. What's lacking is, Gertrude Stein said about San Francisco many, many years ago, there's no there. Because at that time, San Francisco was just a grid with nothing. No iconic pieces, no urban design. And that's what we want to create here. Not a San Francisco, but those elements that make a grid community. So I've said too much, as it is. So what I like now to direct you all to these tables over here. And Kirsten's going to hand out, and the rest of the team, the green and red dots. And again, these are images that we've, from some projects that we've worked on, some images we felt you all needed to look at so that we can start gaining the pluses and minuses of what we want to. And we'll provide some pens here as well. I see some post-its already. So we'll time you guys. It is 6:30, perfect timing. So we have...
she's got a question.
Yes, ma'am.
Do you want a red or a green dot on every picture from everyone?
No. Only the ones that call your name.
Okay.
There's no need to do every single one.
Thank
you. The ones that, obviously, the images that do not have a dot by them, obviously means that didn't make the final cut, didn't make the playoff. So in any event, we'll be around asking questions, the design team, and go at it.